feel like there's not enough light.
Okay, so you want to mount the screen? Can I show you what I want to do? I want to
this. Dang. two foreign ministers are scheduled to meet again on Tuesday to continue their talks. Now turning to the Middle East, the government of Saudi Arabia is offering a plan to bring peace to Yemen after more than 6 years of war. A senior official in Riyadh announced the plan on Monday. It calls for a ceasefire supervised by the United Nations and the start of political negotiations.
We will work with the international community, with our partners, and with the government of Yemen to push toward this initiative being implemented.
But the Houthi rebels want Saudi Arabia to go further. They're asking for a complete lifting of the blockade around Houthi strongholds, including the capital Sana'a. The war pits the Iran-backed rebel group against the Yemeni government, which is supported by Saudi Arabia. One NGO says more than 100,000 people have lost their lives. The U.S. State Department is welcoming the Saudi initiative. It comes weeks after Biden administration said the U.S. would stop arms sales to Saudi Arabia to help end the conflict. Israeli voters are set to head to the polls on Tuesday in the country's fourth general election in 2 years. Veteran Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is seeking to remain in power despite going on trial for corruption. The Israeli parliament was dissolved in December over a disagreement in the governing coalition over a state budget plan. Netanyahu, who has served as prime minister since 2009, touts his achievement of establishing diplomatic ties with Arab nations. He's also counting on the government's speedy rollout of coronavirus vaccines to boost his re-election chances. Netanyahu's right-wing Likud party holds the lead in opinion polls, but opposition parties have strong support. They include two groups led by the former interior and finance ministers.
What?
Protesters in several U.S. cities are standing with their neighbors against racism. They joined in rallies after a spate of attacks on Asian Americans. NHK World's Catherine Kobayashi reports.
Some Asian Americans say they put their head down when they feel flickers of hate. Now they're gathering together with their neighbors with their heads up.
We're just in shock. We want to get everybody here to raise that voice and to get the people to understand the victims' lives matters.
Protesters gathered to mourn the victims of attacks last week on three spas in and around Atlanta, Georgia. A gunman killed eight people, including six women of Asian descent.
We are seeing a historic surge in anti-Asian hate crime compared to all hate crime that's going on.
Some Americans blame people of Asian descent for the pandemic. A national coalition has tracked such discrimination since U.S. cases of coronavirus started increasing a year ago. The group has received more than 3,500 complaints. Many assailants have targeted women and the elderly. Authorities in San Francisco promised to crack down after repeated attacks, but residents have seen even more violence in the past few days.
We need to be able to stand by one another and protect one another.
Asian lives matter!
Asian Americans in New York, too, are watching their backs after a series of assaults.
I know that anti-Asian hate is not new, but it's almost like a neglected diagnosis.
The protesters say they'll stand together in their fight against racism. Still, many are afraid when they're standing alone.
Japan continues to roll out its vaccination program. Currently, the only vaccine being used inside the country is the one produced by Pfizer and BioNTech. But a top health official says vaccines developed by AstraZeneca and Moderna could be approved by the end of May. And on Monday, two Japanese pharmaceutical firms started clinical trials of their vaccines. Daiichi Sankyo says 152 healthy adults are enrolled in its trial. It says researchers will check the safety of its vaccine and whether it helps create antibodies. They will also determine how many doses are needed. The other firm, KM Biologics, says 210 healthy adults are taking part in its Ministry says there are now four firms testing domestically produced vaccines, including Shionogi and Anjess. Meanwhile, AstraZeneca says its vaccine was 79% effective against symptomatic COVID-19 when it compared participants who received it with those who received a placebo. The preliminary results are from the final phase of clinical trials in the U.S., Chile, and Peru. The rollout of the vaccine was put on pause in several countries following reports of recipients developing blood clots. The European Medicines Agency announced last Thursday that an intensive review showed the vaccine to be safe. France, Germany, and other countries have since resumed using the vaccine. The firm says it plans to apply for emergency use authorization in the U.S. The operator of the crippled Fukushima Daiichi power plant is pumping extra water into part of the site. That's after a strong quake last month appeared to cause additional damage. Tokyo Electric Power Company says the level of coolant water inside the number one reactor containment vessel has been dropping following the February 13th earthquake. TEPCO says more water has been leaking as the shaking likely worsened the damage from a massive quake and tsunami 10 years ago. But the company says there are no safety concerns since fuel debris remains cool and the leaking water is trapped in the reactor building. It also says the coolant water is circulated and reused, so the overall volume of contaminated wastewater will not increase significantly. Two U.S. citizens have been indicted in Japan for helping former Nissan Motor chairman Carlos Ghosn escape to Lebanon. Ghosn was awaiting trial on financial misconduct charges. Former Green Beret Michael Taylor and his son Peter Taylor were extradited to Japan in early March. Ghosn was out on bail in December 2019 when prosecutors say the two men hid him in a large case and loaded him into a private jet. Sources say the Taylors have admitted their role in the escape and say Ghosn's wife asked them to arrange it. Investigators in Japan handed over evidence to the U.S. court that Peter Taylor met Ghosn's daughter and received baggage on the day of the escape. There is also evidence he later received nearly $500,000 in cryptocurrency from Ghosn's son. Japanese automakers are assessing the impact of a fire at a major domestic maker of semiconductors. This comes with the industry already facing a global shortage. The fire broke out last Friday at a factory of Renesas Electronics north of Tokyo. Some of the equipment was damaged, and chip production for automobiles was partially halted. Renesas aims to return to full production within a month. Automakers have sent people to the factory to help out. Among the companies that use Renesas chips are Toyota, Nissan, and Honda. Japanese car makers have already had to reduce output due to a global chip shortage. Other chip makers have limited capacity to make up the shortfall. Analysts say the Renesas fire could force automakers to cut output even further.
And now moving on to world weather with our meteorologist, Yoko Komagata. Hello, Yoko.
People in Australia, there has been downpours there and it's leading to major floods. What's the latest?
So people in parts of New South Wales had historic rainfall from severe rainstorms. More showers are expected across eastern portions of the country. As it does so, conditions could even worsen due to additional rainfall. Sydney had more than 250 millimeters of rainfall in the past 5 days. That's two times the monthly average rainfall. The eastern portion of the state have also received severe downpours. Here's a video of what happened over there. Record-breaking rains continue to force many people from their homes in New South Wales. Hundreds of people have been rescued from floods since Sunday. 40 flood warnings and 20 evacuation orders have been issued in the north coast, including western Sydney. Ample moisture from the Pacific will continue to produce widespread showers from the
from Victoria, New South Wales, all the way up to Queensland. An additional rainfall of 100 millimeters is expected in and around Sydney, Canberra, and Melbourne through the next 24 hours. That could lead to further flooding and landslides. Showers will become heavier at times, yet again in Sydney and Melbourne on Tuesday. Some showers will persist in Brisbane, but sunny skies will turn to these areas as we go into Wednesday with warming temperatures. In North America, we have a low-pressure system sweeping across the U.S. plains overnight Monday. Some severe thunderstorms have brought large hail and damaging winds in parts of Texas. Severe weather will be shifting through the upper Midwest and the Gulf states as we go into Tuesday. People in these areas had heavy rainfall from the previous storm last weekend. More rainfall of 300 millimeters is likely in the same locations. That could lead to flash flooding and landslides. Thunder showers are expected in Oklahoma City and Houston on Tuesday. Much cooler temperatures will spread into Denver. Snow is expected on Tuesday morning. That's all for now. Have a nice day.
Special thank you to all of my outstanding patrons for your continued encouragement and support. Patron members get access to hundreds of high-resolution photos, previews of the future material, and direct dialogue with me. If you would like to support my channel, please consider becoming a patron using this link, which is also in the video description. Please also consider hitting the like and subscribe buttons, as this helps as well. Thank you. 8 months have now passed since construction at Giga Texas began. So let's take a look back at how we moved from July 2020 to March 2021 and look at all the changes in construction that has taken place. To do that, we're going to use three highly identifiable areas and then follow a progression for each one of them. The first is the main foundation area, and then the second one will be the paint shop and casting machine area, and then the third will be the stamping machine area. And what we'll do is we'll use a progression of about 4 seconds per month, starting in July and ending in March for each one of them. I'll let the progression run and then we'll have a recap at the end.
L'objectif, se moquer de Joe Biden et de son âge, 60 ans, et le faire passer pour un homme affaibli et incompétent. Pendant la campagne, Donald Trump a lui-même surnommé son adversaire à plusieurs reprises, Joe Landon. Mais l'extrait vidéo partagé par Donald Trump Jr. est trompeur. Sur la chaîne YouTube de Joe Biden, on retrouve la séquence originale. On constate que la vidéo qui circule a été recadrée. Le plan est ici plus large et permet de voir que Joe Biden attend ces deux personnes, à droite, pour quitter les murs. Cet exemple montre qu'il faut aussi nous interroger sur les intentions des personnes qui partagent des contenus, même si cela prend la forme de blagues ou de moqueries. Car les personnalités que j'ai mis en voie peuvent mettre des intox au service de leur discours. D'ailleurs, le Washington Post vérifie maintenant les déclarations de l'élection de Joe Biden.
Souvent à la surface pour dénoncer les violences faites aux migrants. Mais en faisant une recherche d'images inversées, on découvre qu'il s'agit d'une mise en scène réalisée à Chicago en 2004. Cette femme est donc une actrice et l'image n'a rien à voir avec les Ouïghours. Alors, est-ce vraiment grave? L'essentiel n'est-il pas d'alerter sur la situation des Ouïghours? Cette activiste met en garde.
Speaking the truth is very important for us, and if someone sees those pictures and find out if those pictures are fake, still have doubt about the whole lot.
Certains manipulent en connaissance de cause, d'autres relèvent des contenus sans les vérifier et partagent donc malgré eux une fausse information. Soyez malins pour ne pas vous décrédibiliser ou décrédibiliser un mouvement qui vous tient à cœur.
Des informations fiables sur tous les réseaux sociaux, bien entendu, on en trouve également. Une image de mauvaise qualité, une capture d'écran d'un article ou d'un document, ces éléments doivent éveiller votre attention. Essayez toujours de retrouver les origines. Regardez qui publie l'information, lisez les commentaires et utilisez des outils de vérification.
Cette émission a été réalisée en partenariat avec le Centre pour l'éducation aux médias et à l'information. Un grand merci à leurs équipes et aux enseignants des 4 classes investis dans ce projet. Merci surtout aux lycéens de s'être intéressés au travail de vérification de l'information et plus largement au travail des journalistes.
S'informer pour comprendre le monde, c'est le thème de cette 32e édition. On le voit, il va couler un nombre d'interrogations des jeunes et donc de manipulations tournent autour de la pandémie de Covid-19.
Oui, ce qu'on a pu constater en discutant avec les lycéens qu'on a pu rencontrer en visioconférence ou en présentiel pour la préparation de cette émission, c'est que beaucoup en fait, avaient été marqués par le nombre d'informations qui ont circulé autour de la pandémie de Covid-19, des ces informations qui ont pu évoluer aussi dans le temps, ce qui a pu créer aussi de la confusion, comme chez d'autres citoyens aussi, pas forcément que des lycéens, mais ils avaient vu aussi par exemple ce dont on parle dans l'émission, c'est-à-dire des cas de désinformation autour de politiques qui feraient semblant de se faire vacciner par exemple. Alors ils n'y avaient pas forcément cru, mais en tout cas c'est des choses qu'ils avaient vu circuler et qu'ils n'avaient pas forcément pu vérifier. Donc on essaie aussi de donner dans cette émission des méthodes. Ce dont on a beaucoup entendu parler avec les lycéens aussi, c'est les élections américaines. Ils nous en ont beaucoup parlé, les cas de justement d'allégations infondées sur des cas de fraude électorale, tout ce qu'il y a, toutes les intox aussi qui ont décrédibilisé l'administration Biden. Et donc du coup, ça, c'est des choses dont on a pu discuter avec les lycéens et qui ont été assez intéressantes.
Et oui, parce que certains acteurs de l'actualité savent exploiter précisément ce doute, ces failles. C'est effectivement ce qu'on voit, Serge Barbet, cette pandémie, c'est une source d'inquiétude chez beaucoup d'élèves et aussi du coup une opportunité pour les manipulateurs du net.
Bien sûr, on a parlé de infodémie avec l'Organisation mondiale de la santé qui a inventé ce néologisme pour dire la démultiplication sur Internet et sur toutes ces sources de diffusion d'informations, d'infox de plus en plus nombreuses. Et donc il y a un enjeu de citoyenneté majeur puisque aujourd'hui, dans cette jungle de l'information, comment ne pas tomber dans le panneau, comment éviter les pièges et l'éducation aux médias et à l'information sert à cela justement, à former des citoyens libres et éclairés qui maîtrisent tous ces enjeux d'information.
Quand vous voyez des acteurs de l'actualité, des politiques notamment, se saisir eux-mêmes de parfois ces failles et affubler leurs adversaires de ces qualificatifs de fake news, parfois manipuler eux-mêmes à dessein l'information, ça vous évoque quoi ? Est-ce qu'il n'y a pas une véritable responsabilité aussi de ces acteurs ?
D'abord, ça m'évoque Donald Trump, d'une façon contemporaine, celui qui a théorisé la fake news et qui en a fait un arme de communication politique. Au-delà de ça,
en remplaçant l'accusation qui lui a été faite à lui-même quand il parle de réalité alternative, et ses détracteurs, effectivement, ils voient simplement une fake news de
la post-vérité, la manipulation d'informations, les entreprises de propagande, mais c'est vieux comme l'art d'informer finalement. Et on se rend compte que les fausses nouvelles, elles sont vieilles comme nos civilisations, et à partir de la révolution d'imprimerie, on va avoir effectivement des entreprises de mensonges pour manipuler les foules. Le principe de l'éducation aux médias, c'est justement de mettre en alerte les jeunes générations et de leur dire, quel que soit le contenu, aie le bon réflexe, adopte le bon réflexe, vérifie les sources, croise les sources d'informations, vérifie par toi-même, apprends à penser par toi-même. Ensuite, on n'arrêtera pas les mensonges.
C'est le travail qu'effectue justement pour France 24, c'est les OPS, hein, ici même, au sein de notre rédaction, qui recueillent un certain nombre de témoignages vidéo envoyés par nos téléspectateurs. Ça demande une veille permanente, ça va évacuer.
Oui, tout à fait. Donc à la rédaction des observateurs, on a donc une émission qui s'appelle Info ou Intox. Cette émission, on l'a fait toutes les semaines. Ça va être des contenus qu'on a vus soit repérés, nous, journalistes de la rédaction, soit des contenus qui sont aussi remontés justement par les téléspectateurs de France 24. Ils vont contacter la rédaction des observateurs en disant, bon, bah voilà, j'ai vu circuler.
richtig.
ちょっとややこしい話になってくるんですけど、でもなんかさ、音が好きに、玉木くんのことを、なんか、ガチの男性に、ちょっと、
バレへん、バレへん、公開かな。 Thank you. We had the cutting and the pasting. It's just the first part. A lot more to do.
Just to start.
love it when a plan comes together. Yeah. Work on the bottom boards. That's just part one. Probably a whole month left to retouch and cut. But it works.